Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the HMIS training series, summer of 2015. This is part three. This series is for HMIS system administrators, and this third webinar is on how HMIS will be used for system performance measures. I'm Karen DeBlasio. I'm a desk officer in the SNAPS office at HUD headquarters. I have on the phone with me today Michelle Budzek. She's with the Partnership Center. She runs the HMIS Data Lab under contract for HUD. And I also have two national HMIS TA providers, Joel Remigio and Dan Fox. They're both with Cloudburst Consulting Group. They will be, you'll hear from Dan, and Joel will be working with me on the back end to help to answer some questions. Just a couple of things before I hand it over for some administrative comments from Dan. Again, all of these slides have been, as you just saw on the previous slide, all the content here has been reviewed by HUD. The purpose of these webinars has been to train HMIS system admins and HMIS leads on some topics that we felt were pretty important that we needed to make sure that you all understand. So we have the first webinar on back in July on data standards, data entry, and data sharing. We went over critical changes that were recently made to the data standards that we're implementing tomorrow, actually. Part two was at the end of August, and that was on reporting from your HMIS, and then today's obviously is on system performance measures, as I mentioned. Just a couple of things, kind of HUD kind of update type things before we move on, and I hand it over to Dan to go over some just logistics about answering questions and things. I wanted to make sure that everybody knew, so as you know, this is the last in a three-part series that we called our summer training series for this audience, but this does not mean that this is the last time that you'll be hearing from us. We've gotten pretty great response from you all around these webinars and about these webinars. We get a lot of questions during the webinars, and we've got a lot of people registering for them. So it's very clear to us that this is a need, and this type of regular communication with you all, with folks that are in our communities implementing HMIS is really, really important. So we'd like to continue to do these monthly webinars with you. The only change that I would kind of suggest that you'll see is that I think going forward we'd like to start and have one, you know, next month in October. And going forward, we really want to make this a little bit more interactive than just, you know, kind of HUD and a few TA providers on the phone going over a bunch of slides with you. We will use these calls, these monthly calls, as training opportunities, so we will have slides and we will review things and provide guidance. But we are also going to work with you all on trying to determine the best way to make this a little more interactive. So, you know, letting people kind of, you know, unmute themselves, or we, you know, raise your hand and we unmute you so that we can have some conversations. You all can hear from one another. You know, things will, during the discussions and the trainings, things will come up that will, you know, maybe a community may want to jump in and say, hey, we've dealt with this, and here's how we dealt with it, and it worked for us, or we're still dealing with it, and we'd be interested to hear what other folks are doing. So we want to make this a little bit more interactive, but, you know, I have to be honest, it is going to present some challenges because we typically have had, I think, over 700 people register for each one of these webinars. So it is a large group. We're not able to just unmute everybody. That just doesn't work. So we'll be working with you on that and how best to make this, you know, as beneficial for you all as possible. But just know that we definitely plan on continuing these communications and trying to kind of get on everybody's calendar a regular monthly time where we have these calls. Since the last Wednesday of the month was kind of the Wednesday that we picked to do through the summer, we'd like to continue with that if possible. So we are going to plan on having another HMIS lead call on the last Wednesday of October. That said, we would like to solicit input from you all, both around the timing. You know, the last Wednesday of October seems to work, and then that puts us after that. That puts us right into November and holiday season, and it's kind of like the last Wednesday, and doesn't necessarily seem to work, and it's either a holiday time or everybody I know is going to be getting ready to try to pull data for AHAR, and we don't want to impose on other burdens that you all have. So we'll be looking for some input from you all around, does this last Wednesday of the month, 1 to 2:30 time slot work? We know we won't make everybody happy, but you know, if you all have some suggestions or other ideas, we'd love to hear them. We would also love to hear ideas about agenda topics for the next couple of trainings. What we'd like to do is set an agenda for the next couple of months so that you all can see where we're kind of what we'll be talking about. We recognize that just because you show as one person registered, you may have, or one person calling in, you may have five staff sitting with you. And so it may be important for you to know what's going to be on the October call or the November call so that you can pull other staff in, or possibly tell, you know, some of your staff, you don't need to be on this call, but you need to be on the next one or whatever. So we want to be able to give you guys some notice, and so you know what some of the upcoming agenda items are. So we have some ideas. I'm going to start in October with having somebody on the call to present to you all about some of our federal partner programs, since you all are now being expected to work with them and get them involved in your implementation and using HMIS. So we will start either with the VA or with Runway Homeless Youth programs in October. Other than that, though, we really would like to hear from you all on any ideas that you have or training topics that you have. So we would like to, at this point, the best way, I think, for you guys to kind of get those on record rather than just have you email one of us is to put a question in through the AAQ. I monitor, and I have staff that I work with that monitor the help desk. I will let them know that we will have questions coming in, or we will have questions opened by HMIS leads suggesting topics for these webinar series, and they will make sure that I see them. So if you have ideas or thoughts or, you know, suggestions, please go to the help desk, open a question, and just select HMIS, and then tell them that, you know, in response to my request, you'd like to submit some ideas for consideration. The other thing that we are working on that we just don't have finalized yet is the learning management system that one of our other subcontractors runs for us. That you all went there to register for these trainings. We believe that there is a functionality on that system that may allow us to kind of communicate with you, so we could post, as you know, the trainings are posted there after they happen, but we're thinking that there's a functionality that will allow us to maybe post documents or post guidance pieces as they come out, or maybe even do some sort of kind of communication or messaging system. So and that's the way that you all have one place to go, and you can kind of see what we can post agendas, things like that. So that you have to stay tuned for more information on that. I'm working with our contractor to see what the best way to communicate with you all is. So for now, you may just get some emails from us because we have your email now that you registered, but we may have a more efficient way to communicate for all of us to communicate back and forth, but we'll have more on that hopefully by our next meeting by the end of October. And the last thing that I want to say is that we know that we owe you all questions or answers to questions that were posted or that were asked on the first two webinars. We have been going through those. We have them synthesized. We have to make one final pass through them, and then we will get those sent out to you. I didn't want you to think that we forgot about them. We do take that very seriously. We were very kind of anxious to get on the phone today and do a third webinar without having answered your questions from the first two. But we did get a lot of questions, and we just want to make sure that we're putting them, you know, getting the answers correct, and we're putting them out there in a format that's usable for you all. So we will answer the questions or get those posted within the next, I'd say, probably 3 to 5 days. And then we will post the answers to any questions that are asked today on this webinar as well. The final thing I will say is that I, unfortunately, have an appointment that I have to leave for at about 5:02. So, and it's off-site, so I will be dropping off the call while Michelle is probably still going through the slides. So Dan and Joel are still going to be there, and they're still going to be answering questions, but there might be a little bit, you know, there's only going to be two people instead of three answering some of the questions. So, but we will, anything that's not answered, we will definitely get answered for you after the call. So that's all that I have. I want to hand it over to Dan so he can go over just some basic functionality, And then you'll hear from me in a minute as I kind of frame up the presentation for you.
Thank you, Karen. Hello, everyone. Need to go over some, I guess, obligatory housekeeping items here about submitting questions. Clearly, everyone can submit questions through the GoToWebinar functionality itself. We're asking that, even though Joel's posting some things in the chat, for everyone to see, we're asking that people not use the chat function to submit questions, because we won't be monitoring that. The question and answer function, which is titled questions on your GoToWebinar controls, that's what we're using to track questions, and it also gives us the ability to pull the questions out after the webinar, to, you know, speaking towards some of that question answering that Karen was talking about, so that we can make sure to answer everyone's questions. One thing I do want to make up or bring up is, as we've been going through the questions from the past two webinars, typically, and especially around when there's a kind of a something that may not be clear, or maybe something that the presenter needs to restate, there have been a flurry of questions come in without context. And so it helps us track questions, especially since we know that we won't be able to get to all of them. If you can at least reference the slide number when you type in your questions, that way we have an idea of what your question is related to. And then, of course, I need to bring up the Ask a Question feature on the HUD Exchange, and this is where HUD in general tracks all the questions. If we don't get to something today, or you have something that's very specific to your community, please make sure to submit an Ask a Question so that you can get a response that's more specific to you, and it also helps HUD and HUD TA track your questions. And with that, I'm going to turn it back over to you, Karen.
Oh, that was on you. Okay, thanks, Dan. So just one more slide from me, and then I'm going to hand it over to Michelle, and she's going to go over the bulk of the presentation today. Just wanted to give you all some kind of background. As you all know, last summer HUD released some guidance around the system-wide performance measures. This is something that was kind of born out of HEARTH. McKinney-Vento was amended by the Homeless Emergency Assistance and Rapid Transition to Housing Act, or HEARTH. So in amending McKinney-Vento, in HEARTH amending McKinney-Vento, Congress wrote in some language around some ways that HUD would be expected to kind of measure performance in communities. So it took quite a long while for us to kind of decipher that language in the authorizing legislation, to come up with some, kind of practical, fair measures that we could put forth for communities. We had a lot of kind of things that we looked at when we were looking at these performance measures. First and foremost, what data were you already collecting? We did not want these to turn into a whole additional data collection burden for you all and for your communities. We also, built in kind of time and the expectation, and that's why we released these last summer, as really just a kind of overview. Here are the measures, and here's what HUD is thinking, but we haven't really begun to ask for, much reporting out on these yet, mainly because it's going to take time, because this is really the first time, obviously, that HUD is asking for communities to look system-wide. For years we've done APRs and project-level reporting, but this is a shift. We know many communities for years have looked at these types of measures or looked at things across their community, but many haven't, and this is the first time that HUD is requiring that. So we really, wanted to kind of think about how best to do this, and again, come up with some practical measures that would be helpful to you all. They're obviously helpful for HUD as we look at this. We will be looking at this data and making policy at a national level, but then we also wanted it to be helpful for you, because the last thing that we really want is for you to collect data just to turn it over to HUD. It should be useful for you all in your communities as you're working with your COCs. So, and then finally, we have recently released programming specifications. And the third bullet says we really looked at the measures to determine exactly how they should be pulled from HMIS. And so we worked very closely with the vendors around these as well. We presented the measures to them. We heard them tell us what may not work or what would work better. And so we've spent a lot of time trying to kind of get these finalized in a way that they can be programmed into HMISs, and then, you know, the reports can be generated. So, or the system, the measures can be pooled, I should say, because there is no system measure report at this point. So that's a little bit of the background. I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to Michelle. She's going to do the rest of the slides and give you, and really dive in and give you all of the information on getting these measures in your systems and pulling the data.
Hi, everybody. This is Michelle Budzek. I'm at the HMIS Data Lab in Cincinnati at the Partnership Center, and I'm joined by David Derkowski, who's our senior programmer here, and he's the guy that is the main author of the programming specs that you can find on the HUD Exchange. As Karen said, these specifications were determined by HUD how they would be pulled. As you look at each question, you could imagine 10 ways to pull the answer to that question. And believe me, we imagined all 10 of those ways as we were preparing through this. And HUD selected the way they want the measure reported. So the programming specifications lay out for the HMIS vendors exactly how to pull the numbers for each one of the questions, and those are what HUD expects to be followed for programming for this. We need to share with you, because we know that some of you might try to do this on your own, that there is no way, I'm going to repeat that, no way to program this from the front end of an HMIS system by a system administrator. This is back end functionality at fairly high levels, and you can't do it yourself. So hopefully what we're doing here today is giving you the ability to understand what your vendor or whoever's programming your system has done for you. So let's start and just kind of look at where the measures start. When you report on these measures, and HUD still has not determined what vehicle they're going to use to have you report on them, whether that's going to be eSNAPS through your continuum application or eSNAPS separately or the HDX. But when you report on them, you will always be reporting on a federal fiscal year, October 1 to September 30th. So everybody's year across the country will be the same, October 1 to September 30th. We've established what we call a look-back start date. That's 10-1-2012. That means that the questions should never look back before the date of 10-1-2012. There's one exception to that, and that would be in the cases where we're looking back and somebody is in a project on 10-1, we would look back all the way to their entry date. But we're only talking about clients then that would be active from 10-1-2012 forward. And we recognize, like I'm sure all of you do, that every day when you pull from your live active HMIS system, your answers may be different because it's a real-time live data system. So HUD will do something to store your answers from this year so that you can look at your answers. They'll be compared to your answers from next year. You won't have to every year put in last year's information. Next slide. We're going to also look at the – at where you start with these measures today. So we're going to go through each measure and look at which project types have to be active in your system for that measure to function. Which project types is it pulling from? So when we're talking about system-wide performance measures, we're going back to that HMIS project type element and coding off of that element that says this is an emergency shelter, this is a transitional housing project, or this is a permanent housing project. And that's creating the core of how the system knows what to pull. So your project types in the system have to be set up right. It's really critical that all of your continuum of care projects, all of your federal partner funded projects are all typed right, because the system performance measures pulls not only from the continuum of care projects, but also the ESG projects and the projects that are not funded by anybody that are on your system, like the missions, and are pulling from the projects that are funded by our federal partners, RI and VA and PATH. The higher the participation rate is in your system, the more accurate the measure is going to be. So if you are sitting in a community with only 50% of your emergency shelters on HMIS, your accuracy is much, much, much less than a community with 100% participation. And HUD knows that, but you should also know it. That the goal is to increase your participation rate, not decrease your participation rate through this. Also, the higher your data quality is, the more likelihood you have to have accurate system performance measures. And so to that end, we're going to also look at which data elements for each measure is collected and reported on, so that you can take a look at the accuracy for each one of those elements for a question. There are, next slide, there are several elements that are, or several uses that you have for these measures. The bottom line is that we're asking you to take a look at how your continuum is generally performing and increase the performance year to year. And that's what HUD is going to do. HUD is going to look at your performance measured against your performance. They're not going to look at your performance measured against your neighbor community's performance. There's a variety of issues in doing that include data quality and participation levels. So this is really a look at your performance levels. HUD will be releasing a video series shortly that's really pretty neat. It's a whiteboard series that in a very simple way describes each one of these measures that you may want to consider using with your end users, because in general it really talks about how they calculated the measure. They're pretty nice. But they also suggest that you do deep dives into your data to look at where the problems are coming from, so that you can take a look, you can drill down into the data to take a look at problem areas or where you're really doing well, where you're achieving. So those videos will be coming out shortly, and we're hoping in the next couple of weeks even, so that you'll be able to do that. There are a series of elements that are used in almost every measure, and these elements are critical that you make sure that you're capturing. So the first is client location. That's element 3.6 in the universal data elements. We're going to filter out anybody who isn't part of your COC. So if for some reason you have for example, a hopeful program that crosses multiple COCs, you're just going to pull the hopeful clients that are residing or are being served in your COC. And we went through all of that client location stuff when we talked about system setup and for each one of the federal partners. And there's guidance online on the HUD Exchange about system setup if you don't know how to do that. You have no control of the personal ID. The system controls that, but we'll be using those. We'll be using the project entry ID. Again, you don't have any control of the project entry ID. That should be a system setting, a system function. But each kind of project is going to, we need to link together data for a specific person, for a specific stay by the project entry. We use that household ID to link household members together. So that's critical that that's filled in. We use the relationship to head of household to link households together. And dates of birth to figure out who's, of course, a child and who's an adult. It's important, I think, that you understand what an active client is. An active client is somebody that has some kind of activity going on in your system within the reporting range. So within that federal fiscal year, the report start date to the report end date, it's somebody who's had an activity. So it's somebody that entered a project or exited a project or has been active in a project, been residing in the project. Has entered but hasn't exited yet, and they've been in the project the whole year. It's also the people that have used a bed night in an emergency shelter during the year or have been enrolled in a street outreach project. So the activity means that those are only the people that we're counting. So it's also important that you, it'll make it easier on your system to run these measures if you've exited the people that have had no activity over the course of a year and do perform some auto-exiting kind of functions on your, especially your MASH shelters. It'll just make your whole system easier to run if you've actually exited the folks in your MASH shelters. So let's take a look at the first performance measure. That's the length of time people remain homeless. And it's going to pull from the project types on the right hand of your screen. So that would be emergency shelter, transitional housing, safe haven, the PSH programs, the permanent housing that's housing only, like your SROs, the permanent housing with services that don't require a disability, and your permanent housing rapid rehousing projects. So all of those projects are being looked at in this. And we're going to also use the data elements that are on the left side of your screen to pull that. So we're going to pull from we have to use the method for tracking emergency shelters. So we need to know whether it's a night-by-night method or an entry-exit method. That element 2.5 should be turned on for each one of your shelters and set according to the kind of shelter it is. We'll look at, of course, the project entry date and the project exit date for the clients. We're not going to use 3.17 the first year, but the years following we'll use 3.17, and that's the length of time on the streets, shelters, or safe havens. We know that you are just changing that, and with the critical changes that were out this year, that whole element has been reconstructed, so that element will not be used in the calculations until the following year. But it will be used in the following year. And then we're going to look at residential move-in date. These elements, there's a measure 1A and a measure 1B. The difference between those two elements, or those two tables, is that 1B also includes 3.17 data. So what we're doing here is looking at how long somebody's been homeless during the report range, as well as prior to the report range for their person's starting date. So we're going to go backwards. We're going to take the client, we're going to go backwards and count all the days that they've been homeless. Remember that these are system performance measures. They're not project performance measures. So when somebody goes from shelter A to shelter B and it's a continuous day, that keeps counting them. If they've then they go to a transitional housing program, it keeps counting them. So we're looking at the stays of a time that a person has been homeless within that report period. The 3.17 element the following year will be added to the end of the days. So if somebody's been homeless 2 months, but in element 3.17, they also report to us that they've been homeless for another 2 months prior to entry, we're going to add that other 2 months onto their 2 months in shelter. Again, we won't do that this year. We'll be doing it next year. So as you get folks started using 3.17 right, coming up here in October, it's really important that we get it down, because we're going to be using that for these performance measures in the future. Let's go to the next slide and measure two. So in measure two, we're taking a look at people who exited homelessness to a permanent housing destination and returned to homelessness, sometimes called recidivism. The only people that are being measured in this measure are people who exited to a permanent housing destination. So if you exited your emergency shelter to the streets, you're not getting counted. It's only if you exited to a permanent housing destination in this. So again, we're using the project types on the right. And obviously, it's important to know when they entered and exited the project so that you know if they're an active client during the year and what destination they're going to, so that you know if they've exited to a permanent housing program. So we're going to first take a look at each client from their earliest project stay in the date range. And if they said they exited to permanent housing, then we're going to take a look and see how many people come back to a homeless project of any type that we've looked at in the future. So if you exited emergency shelter to a permanent housing destination, and we find that you came back to a street outreach project, we're going to count you as returning to homelessness. But we're also going to count you as returning to homeless if you left an emergency shelter project and 45 days later you show up at a transitional housing project and they take you in. We're going to count that as a return to homelessness also. So we're looking at the number of people that have returned to homelessness. Now we understand that for as much as regulations tell us that people have to move directly from an emergency shelter to permanent housing or an emergency shelter to transitional housing and be homeless to be eligible. We also understand that in the real world, sometimes people get an apartment and don't go immediately to that apartment. The shelter is full and they'll stay a couple of days with their mom and then they'll go and move into the permanent housing project. And so we've created for you a 14-day window from the movement to transitional housing and to permanent housing to account for those. So we're looking at then the person's continuous stay during the date range, during the project year, their continuous stay in a project. Once that stay is broken by more than 14 days, if they're going to a shelter transitional housing project, and then they show up again, that's what we're looking for. Do I need to stop for questions? They're telling me I do. In Measure 1, they're asking how permanent housing data is used in Measure 1. David's going to answer that for you.
Hello, this is David Drakowski here at the Partnership Center. That data is not used, it's not reported as time that a person has spent as homeless, because, you know, at the point you're in permanent housing, so you're not really homeless. But what it does do is it does serve to negate time that might also be reported in your system that you were homeless. So, for example, I'm in a shelter, I'm going to permanent housing on Monday morning. So I turn up, I'm at permanent housing, they put my record into HMIS and they date it Monday morning. But for whatever reason, there's a delay at the shelter, so they don't exit me there until Wednesday, and they make a boo-boo on the date. So according to them, I was in the shelter, you know, Monday night and Tuesday night. But the permanent housing record, as it's indicated, as it's specified in the specification, will serve to chop off those dates that I'm in the shelter that I really wasn't in the shelter. And we do that just on sort of general principle that the data entry in those permanent housing programs is just likely to be a little bit more accurate, especially when you consider some of the mass shelters that are relying on individual bed night records or whatever, and the record keeping may just not be quite as good.
So there's a question about emergency shelters and night-by-night shelters and having no destination recorded for them. There is still the expectation that you're trying to do a project exit from a night-by-night shelter. It's not like a free pass that you don't have to do the universal data elements with those folks. So to the extent you have exit destinations, we're going to pick up those exit destinations. And to the extent you say exited without doing an exit interview, then they're not going to count. There's not a way to make up where did they go when you didn't tell us where they went. So those won't be counted, and there's no other methodology of picking that up than by doing those exits. So I think you're going to find that the performance measures and the combined with the new ESG taper measurements of exits are going to encourage your emergency shelters to move from that kind of mass sheltering approach where everybody's just doing whatever they want to an entry-exit methodology that's much more structured, if you will, and you're going to get some better information on people and be able to get better performance measurement on that. It's definitely something to contemplate as you move forward. Let's take a look at Measure 3 then. In Measure 3, we're looking at the number of people who are homeless and the change in the point in time count. And for the first measure, there's two measures in measure three. For the first one, it's a straight up pip count. It's exactly what you reported to HUD in the pip. No changes, no updates, no corrections, exactly what you reported for your pip count is what you're going to report here, and we're going to take a look at the current year and the previous year. But then in measure 3B, we're going to take a look at, on the next slide, we're going to take a look at exactly what your HMIS says about the people that were counted on your PIP. So it's going to look at how many people were sheltered, how many people were in safe havens, how many people were in transitional housing during the range, and look and compare this year to last year. So we're looking at both what you reported in the PIP and what HMIS has recorded in HMIS. And we know those numbers may not be the same, but that's what we're looking at, and we're looking at the differences between the 2 years. So that's how we're determining the change in annual count, is both by a combination of using the PIP and using your actual HMIS data. On measure four, as we go to measure four now, we're looking at employment and income growth for homeless people. This is one of those elements that it's really important that you have also set your federal partner funding status correctly. So this element is only going to pull from projects where the federal partner funding status is a COC program. It will not pull in our federal partner programs or any other projects. So it's only going to pull in projects that have been identified as being funded by the COC or in any one of the COC project types or components. It is taking a look only at adults, just like all income does. It looks only at adults. So it looks at all of the household income as it's reported on in the adult record. So I know I answer this question periodically on the AAQ. You know, if a child gets Social Security check, that child's check should get reported under the adult's record at this point, and the adult's, you know, usually that would be the head of household's adult record, but it could be any adults in the household because we're going to pull the adults. It's important that you just kind of lodge in your head that we're talking about system stayers and system leavers now. So it's not project stayers and project leavers like you're used to. So when we usually do income on an APR, we're doing that for the people in the APR that left that project during the year, or people in the project that stayed were still in the project at the end of the year. We're going to take those concepts of stayers and leavers, but apply them to the whole system. Now we're going to look at, did they leave the system and not show up again? And now we're going to start counting their exit from entry to exit. The measurements for increase for income takes a look at the difference between stayers and leavers, and takes a look at the difference between employment income and total income. So, and non-cash income, or non-employment income. So, again, it's that same segregation of income that you're familiar with on the APR, whether it's earned income or whether it's income from any other source, a public benefit or another source. And we're going to measure those based on the source, the kind of income it is, and then the amount of income it is to look at people that, the number of people that go up and down. on measure five. Dan, go back. So measure four uses these project types and these fields, and I couldn't get them on the slide, so they had to sit on their own slide. Sorry about that. So you'll see the federal partner funding sources there. The date of birth is there so that we're sorting out which ones are the adults versus which ones are the children, the project entry date and exit date, and the income and sources then. And we're using the following types on the right. You'll see that we're not measuring income for this measure based on their emergency shelter state. So the income measurement starts at transitional housing and goes forward. Doesn't include those street outreach folks or emergency shelter folks that, you know, again, if you're in a mass shelter, you're probably not on a night-by-night method collecting change in income. So we've just knocked those project types completely out. Okay, somebody apparently wants me to define the difference between a system and a COC. So your system, a system-wide continuum, is everybody that provides housing and services to homeless people. I used to say that COC is used at least two different ways, and some people would argue it's used three ways. The first way is that it's a grant, right? The COC program, the grant funds that you get. And sometimes we talk about it as an application, COC program application, and we have a competition like going on right now. But the continuum itself and what that application is actually measuring is all the activity in your community that's going on to serve the homeless. Whether the continuum of care funds it, or it's funded privately, or it's funded by one of our federal partners. All of that activity, all of the emergency shelters, no matter who funds them, are part of the system. All of the transitional housing projects for the homeless, not projects that are not for homeless folks, where the bed is not designated as a homeless bed, like a substance abuse bed that's part of a detox program. That doesn't count. Projects that are where the bed is designated for a homeless person in transitional housing, no matter who funds that bed, is going to count. So if it's a RIE TLP bed, a runaway and homeless youth TLP bed, it's part of the system. If it's a COC-funded transitional housing bed, it's part of the system. When we're looking at permanent housing, we're looking at permanent supportive housing that maybe your old SHP stuff, maybe your old shelter plus care stuff, but maybe the Gates Foundation came in and gave you a bunch of money to house homeless people and totally separate, totally outside of the continuum of care. That's part of your homeless system then. If you're housing homeless persons with those funds, those are all part of your system, and all of those projects are expected to be on HMIS. And those are the projects that we're using, and that's why project typing, that kind of stuff, is really important. So we're not counting a permanent housing project as a shelter because it's mistyped. As we look at measure number five, it's kind of a backwards way to look at recidivism. It's going to look at people who became homeless for the first time ever. So instead of how many people return to homelessness, we're looking at how many new people are coming in the front doors of our system. Are we stemming the tides on homelessness, or is the flow still coming? And so We're going to work backwards in time with the client's earliest date in any relevant period and look back and see, have we seen them before all the way back till October 1st of 2012? We know that you might have seen them in 1999 and that they showed back up again. We're not going to go that far back. We're going to go back to October 1st, 2012 and stop there, and that's the point that we're looking back to see how many people are new to homelessness since October 1st, 2012. And the one measure looks at how many people entered emergency shelter, safe havens, or transitional that were new, that were the first time we ever saw them. And the second measure is going to look at how many people entered emergency shelter, safe haven, transitional housing, or permanent housing, and were the first time homeless. And you might say, well, wait a minute, I thought you had to be homeless to enter permanent housing and had to maybe come from a shelter or the streets. And that's true, but it's also true that we have a housing first methodology in many, many, many of the cities. So many of the cities, somebody could be on the streets in a street outreach program, and the first time the HMIS system touches them is at project entry at permanent housing. And so we're going to pick those kind of housing first folks up using that measure 5.2, we hope. Measure 6, you all have a buy on. It's the measure that's going to look at homeless prevention and housing placement of persons defined by Category 3, HUD's definition of homeless programs. Category 3 is those persons from, defined as homeless from other federal projects or by other federal definitions other than the definition that HUD uses. And at this point, there's no continuum of care that's authorized to serve Category 3 persons. And so this measure will not be measuring that until the point that a continuum goes through the process of requesting to serve the Category 3 person and has been approved by HUD. And when that happens, then for that community, Measure 6 will apply. So at this point, you all get a buy on Measure 6, and you don't have to take a look at that. The last measure is Measure 7, and we're going to look at successful placements from street outreach and placements in or retention of permanent housing. So the first one, the first measure is from all those people who left street outreach, where did they go? Of those who exited, how many went to a temporary or institutional destination versus how many went to a permanent housing destination? And we've taken the destinations and removed some of them from the count. So of the universe of people who exited street outreach, we're going to remove anybody that exited street outreach to a hospital or medical facility. We're going to remove anybody who left and went to a halfway house with no homeless criteria. And we're going to remove anybody who died. So you don't have to worry anymore on the exit destinations about those folks. In the next measure, when we're going to look at persons who exited emergency shelter, safe haven, transitional, or RRH, you're going to also be able to exclude some other folks. So the measures will never count anybody who exited to foster care as either a positive or a negative measurement. They're going to be removed from the universe completely. Same with hospital, Same with long-term care facility or nursing home. So we're just going to, and same for anybody that died that was marked deceased. So those folks who may have exit destinations that are kind of specialized in nature, if you will, are going to be removed from the universe of people that have been counted on. So the first measure looked at just the people in street outreach. The second measure is going to look at all these people in shelters, safe havens, transitional, RRH. And the next measure is going to look at all persons in permanent housing except those who are in RRH because they're counted in the previous measure. So all of those who are in permanent housing. And we're looking at the change in exits or retention of permanent housing for each one of those groups. So I'm hoping that if you didn't hear anything else in this presentation, you heard how complex these measures are to program, and that you understand that the programming really has to be done out of the main system, can't be done kind of on the side, and is important that that they follow the programming specification methods, because we've given you very precise ways that HUD expects this information to be pulled, and you want to measure it and need to measure it the way HUD has put forth. So if there are questions, I guess, Dan, you're going to take a look at questions or field questions here. Dan and Joel?
Sure. So while we're looking at the questions that have been submitted through the Q&A function, I also want to let people know that you can raise your hand, and what we'll try to do here, since we're at the end of the presentation, is unmute your line. You just have to make sure if you're dialing in on the telephone that you've entered your PIN number. So I already have some verbal questions ready to go, Michelle, so give me just a minute here. Deborah, I'm going to unmute you first. Give me a second.
Hi, Deborah, are you there?
Deborah,
maybe right. You're on mute. Want to go to the next one then?
All right. So, yep, I'm going to try Richard right now. Richard, you're muted. And you guys will hear a notification when you've been unmuted on your end. These first two might have been carryovers from when people were raising their hand earlier.
Oh, yeah, I didn't mean to raise my hand. That was a mistake.
Oh, okay. All right, so Beverly, I'm going to unmute you now.
So I've been listening to you all talk about how complicated these performance measures are, but I noticed on the recent NOFA that's been released, there are performance measures that you're expecting the COC to report in on. Any direction on how we can achieve that?
The current application does not carry any of these performance measures in the application, and the HMIS vendors have been told that they have until January 1st to release the measures. So
okay.
None of these measures should be included in this year's application. You shouldn't have to worry about that one.
I think there are some measures. I know that our COC gave us a list of things that they wanted us to do as far as some systems performance measures. What I can do is I can get what I'm talking about from the COC and I can scan them and email them to somebody and see if someone can give us some direction on what we're supposed to do to gather the numbers.
If you put the question in the AAQ under HMIS and indicate that it's a question from this this call, this this conference call, we'll, one of us will get the question then. So you can put it in that way.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. Next.
All right, Suzette, you're unmuted.
I'm sorry, I did not have a question.
Okay.
Well, it was good to talk to you anyhow, Suzette.
Great talking to you also, Michelle.
All right, that's all for the hands raised at the moment. Joel, did you have something you wanted to call out from the Q&A?
Yes, actually, I've been trying to unmute my phone unsuccessfully, but I made it. With regard to the NOFA and the system performance measures, there is a section in the NOFA, yes, on system performance, and it talks about some of these same topics, all right? But you're not being asked to submit these measures, per se, in your NOFA. You're being asked to sort of, it's more or less to describe the method by which you're going to, you know, report on these things. Let me pull up the NOFA real quick and try to give an example. Reduction in the number of first-time homeless, right? That's in the NOFA. It is. There's a whole section on that, and it's worth a certain number of points. And it says the maximum number of points will be awarded to CFCAs to identify the process by which risk factors are identified in this community for becoming homeless for the first time, and describe the strategies and partnerships in place to address individuals and families at risk of becoming homelessness. So it's yes, it's there, and they are calling it system performance, but it's more talking about your strategies for addressing that than to actually produce something out of HMIS that says, here's a number, and this is what we're dealing with.
All right, I see Suzette raised her hand again. Let me make sure that Suzette, did you have a question this time?
No. No, I'm sorry. No, I do not. I don't know why I keep raising. I do apologize.
No worries.
Maybe she's just waving goodbye or something, Suzette, or is that...
I think she wants us to answer her question she typed in. Veronica, I'm going to unmute you now.
Hi, can you hear me?
We can.
Excellent. So my question is this. I am the HMIS lead. Somebody else in my agency, my boss, is the COC lead. And she is requesting length of stay right now for the NOFA. And so I'm wondering if there's any way to put that slide back up so that I can print it really quick and write what you just said on it and give to her. Because she's thinking they want numbers.
Sure, give me a moment here. And we will, by the way, have I have the screen in my way. We will have these available to you know, to print out from the website, but of course that will take a little bit longer for us to get those uploaded. So.
Right, and for me to remember what I
wanted
to write on
it. Do you recall which slide it was?
It was the one that had the different. I noted it in my head, but I didn't think to do print screen until a different slide. It's the one that had 3.17 listed with others down below. There, that's the one. Okay.
You can save that as a bitmap to your desktop as well, right from the controls in the top right.
Really? Let's see.
So I'm going to mute you here and give you a second that you can print that off, and we're going to move on.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Lisa, you're unmuted. Whoops. Actually, give me just a moment. Sorry. Lisa, can you raise your hand again? Thank you. There you go. You can
okay,
ask your question
now.
Yep.
Okay. If a COC does not have a street outreach program, how will that impact the measurement where they're looking at street outreach to successful program entry?
Michelle?
Yeah. so you're being compared to yourself. So it's not going to affect you. The other thing that I wanted to say to the gal that was looking for the charts, that all the charts are in the system performance measure programming specifications that are online on the HUD exchange. So if you go in the HMIS section and you go in the section that says HMIS vendors, the programming specifications reside there, and you should be able to find them. I know the HUD exchange sometimes is hard to find things on, but that should be where they are. Go ahead, Dan.
Okay. Kim, I can't unmute you because you haven't entered your PIN. So if you enter your PIN number, which will be under the audio section, I'll be able to unmute you. Adam, go ahead. You're unmuted.
Hi. I have a night-by-night seasonal shelter. It kind of runs between our fall and early end of winter. There's really no level of case management done, so tracking the determination of where these people go after they leave my seasonal shelter. I've tried, again, there's really no level of case management. Essentially, it's a night-by-night winter shelter, but
yeah,
tracking the destination for those individuals that for a program that does not provide any level of case management to those participants, how can I track those destinations?
You can't, and we recognize that. So we do recognize that you have a night-by-night shelter going on there, and those shelters, we know that the exit destination in those kind of winter shelters, seasonal shelters, is virtually abysmal.
Thank you for recognizing my pain, Michelle. Thank you very much.
I completely do.
All right, Kim, I'm trying to get you. Go ahead.
Hi. So regarding the street outreach, I said a lot of the time some of our kids just stop showing up, so we cannot complete an exit interview with them, and so there's no data to be entered, and we generally exit them from the system within after 6 months of no contact. Will we be dinged for that?
No, we know that that's going to happen, and we know that there are exits without an exit destination. I'm trying to look up in the new data standards. There's a response for that, even to give you the ability to kind of, if you want to do a deep dive in this, to figure out how many people left to never did an exit interview. So there's an option now where no exit interview is completed on those people. So like the last caller with the winter shelter and you that's got people just leaving, you really want to make sure that you've exited them to no exit interview completed, so that in the future, as you're looking at the implication of these measures on your performance in your community, you kind of get a handle on what's going on there.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure that that's yeah, not going to report poorly on it. Okay, thank you.
Well, you know, so So let's talk about perform poorly or look poorly on you. It's when they don't do an exit interview, they have probably not really engaged in a solution to their personal situation of homelessness. And so overall, what your continuum is looking at is not just this number of performance measures, but what can you do to impact the number? So what does it take for your community to actually begin to engage more people so you have less people leaving without an exit destination and more people who have actually engaged with you and begun working on a plan? So the rate of engagement in a night-by-night shelter, in at least my mind, is way more important almost than where did they go. Because when I see that the client has been engaged in a night-by-night shelter, I now know that there's somebody working with them and that client is willing to work on a plan to go forward. And whether they could actually get to that plan this time or not, okay, I get it. I get everybody isn't gonna get there always at the same time, but I now know that that person has had the opportunity to engage. So we're gonna as you do deep dives into these measures, you're going to look at these night-by-night shelters or the whole emergency shelter system, hopefully in a whole different light, hopefully not just in a light of how many people pass through the door, but in the light of what can we be doing differently in our community, in our system, to more fully engage these people to develop a plan for themselves that's going to work for them to get them off the streets. I can take the next one, Dan.
That's all the hands that are raised at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Somebody just showed me that there's a question about comparable databases. This does not pull in any of the information from your comparable database. You don't have to do that. So your domestic violence shelters do not have to come in to these counts or to these system-wide measures. You don't even have to try to do that, nor for the legal services comparable databases. So if you have people in your communities using those systems, you don't have to bring in that data for these measures. Joel, you got anything else?
Let's see, there was a cluster of questions on, where did we go here? I think we talked about the outreach. I guess back to 3B, if we scroll back that far. Or I guess forward from where we are right now. Folks wanted clarification on this one, that it is an annual count.
Yep. It's an annual count from a federal fiscal year count of how many people shelters right. Safe haven and transitional housing. It's not a point in time. It's an annual count.
Yeah, right. How will this relate to the point in time then?
The difference is where it could be related is the percent difference significant. So one is looking at a point in time and one is looking at an annual count, and we understand that there's a difference in those two counts. Yeah, they're separate. They're not compared to each other necessarily.
Right. So they don't really relate directly to each other.
Not directly.
All right, Gino, I'm going to unmute you now. Go ahead.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure. I wrote down from earlier in the webinar that specifically measure three was directly related to the pit count. That's what I thought I heard. So it's not, is what we're saying, right?
Well, so there's a difference, right? It's the same measure going two different ways. One is an annual count and one is a point in time count. But for each one, this table is the same, and there's a difference there, right? So it does look at the difference between what your one night in the universe looks like versus what does your 1 year look like. And can take a look, you can take a look at the differences between your one night and your annual count. So those two do relate to each other in that they're counting the same thing in two different ways. But the difference is that should be percentage-wise, we should be kind of lined up there. They're not going to be the same numbers, though.
Right. All right, great. That answers my question.
Okay. Sorry if I confused y'all on that.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you.
Uh-huh.
All right, Michelle, we have I'm going to try to summarize a few different questions here together. We have a few questions about the applicability of these measures to all projects in a quote-unquote COC, you know, especially projects from other funders, including federal partners and privately funded. A, is that audience literally everyone? And also,
yep.
Has any consideration been given to the fact that some of these other, organizations that serve homelessness or serve homeless folks might be using a different definition?
Yeah, we are very much aware of the definitions that are in play. We're very much aware that there are a variety of competencies, experience, however you want to say that, using HMIS, and that especially as the federal partners come on, I know for many of you it's been especially difficult bringing on your RI providers and across the country, we've done a great job of trying to get there from here, but getting there is tough, and that your data quality might not be as good as you would like it to be from a new project coming on. That's just the way it is, and we recognize that. HUD knows that. HUD and the federal partners know that all of their projects are a part of these system performance measures, and all of the participants in their projects are part of these system performance measures. And the partners are aware of that, and so is HUD. So I don't want to tell you that HUD, it sounds like every time I answer the question, I say, yeah, HUD has taken that into account. I can tell you that every one of these issues that you've talked about, in the course of programming these measures, we've talked about ad nauseum with them to make sure that they were really well aware of how bad the data quality could be or should be or would be. But also we looked at how important it is to include things like street outreach in the PATH program that are seriously mentally ill brothers and sisters that are living on the streets aren't included in measures unless we bring them into these performance measures. And what difference does that make in the systems? So one of the reasons you see the tables broken out two and three and four different ways is so that HUD can get a handle on that and so that you as communities can get a handle on that. So the only thing I can tell you is that they recognize it, they know it, you're comparing yourself to yourself, you're not comparing yourself to another community, and you're looking at increasing your performance, and you're looking at ways to show HUD how you increase that performance or what issues you had in the process of doing that.
All right, so we have 4 minutes left here, so make sure if you have questions that you raise your hand so we can unmute you. And I also wanted to put another question here in front of you, Michelle. Why does Measure 5 not include street outreach projects? That's the question that was typed in.
Because they decided not to? I don't know. There's some recognition that all communities aren't, that communities don't have many street outreach projects or don't have many on the system, or that they're also, many of them, most of them, are funded by our federal partners, not by HUD. So there was an awful lot of conversation on almost every measure of whether to include street outreach and what that would do to the measure. And they elected not to on this measure. I don't know that I can tell you why, but just that they did it. And the discussions were fairly high level. I mean, these weren't, it wasn't a minor HUD staff making these calls. These were senior staff people making the determinations of whether they were including these measures or not.
Joel, I think I accidentally cut you off earlier. Did you have a question you thought should get raised to the top of the pile, so to speak?
No, just broadly, the last point Michelle made about COCs. There were a bunch of questions, different scenarios of folks having trouble getting participation in HMIS and feeling like they're, going to suffer as a result. Like Michelle said, the system performance measures are relative to your own COC year to year, not to your neighbors. So where you may not have is, you're missing a large shelter that refuses to participate in HMIS, and so that sort of hinders what you're able to do with your system performance measure as well. If they're not there next year, it's just going to show up the same way, and it won't really impact you. In fact, if you ever convince them to participate in HMIS, that'll help your system performance measures, and your performance could increase significantly year to year. But that sort of, we had a lot of questions come up like that about different scenarios and how they're feeling like being, folks might suffer if they're not getting a lot of participation. I mean, you do want that participation, and we can't stress that enough, because the data quality itself needs to be good, but you are being compared to yourself, not across the continuum, the other continuum.
I think a lot of these questions, Michelle, we're going to have to answer offline, because they have a lot of specificity to them.
Okay. Well, we thank everybody for participating.
Oh, you know what? I do have one thing, Michelle, that we did not state that I think is a good question from an expectation perspective of the HMIS system administrators and COCs. Can you provide a deadline that the HMIS software solutions were given to have these implemented by? In their software?
January 1st, 2016. They've all been told January 1st, 2016. And in fact, I know that a number of them, some of the bigger systems have been holding out until then and are doing some major system testing of their performance measures. Again, these are complicated measures to program and are in the process of testing. And I know one vendor just sent out to their customers, a note saying HUD doesn't expect it until January 1st, and we're not going to be there till January 1st because they were in the process of testing. So you may have them before then, but when you should expect them is the beginning of the year.
All right, apologies for cutting you off there. I just I saw that one last minute.
No, that's a great question. Thank you all for participating. We loved having you with us. Please tell us in the AAQ what other kinds of topics you would like to hear about so that we're doing something that's meaningful to you, not something that's meaningful to somebody else. And we look forward to talking to you again next month on the last Wednesday of the month.